this. Today, we are going to... So, we learned about different types of weaving. One is effective. Projection lines are now bind the equation with respect to perspective projection. Right? Okay, suppose that the camera is at origin 0, 0. It is pointing at the negative z direction, and assume that the projection plane is in front of the camera. Obviously, I should have a camera and there has to be projection plane on top of that. I get my object. Okay, next. With the above arrangement, a point in a space at the point xyz, so xyz is a point, is projected along the projector onto the point xp, yp, zp. Okay, so this is all shown here. So if I take this consideration, okay, so xp, zp and yp projected along the line xyz. Now, if I see the same diagram right from the top side, okay, how it looks like? This is a top wave where you can find this as x point, okay, and this point can be considered xp, d, and this distance, what you get the distance d. Okay, so this is a top wave. Okay, and when I say the side view, okay, right from the y axis, okay, this will become a y, okay, and equal to d. Okay, so this is a side wave. So now considering this thing, this is three directional, this is top wave and this is a side wave. Now the above equations can be, okay, now with respect to this, what I can write is zp equal to d, that is distance d. Okay, now x by z, x by z equal to d. Okay, now what I do, how can I get the xp? Xp equal to x by z by d. So same way, how I can obtain the y right from the yp from the side view, okay, right from top view, okay, this is how, right, you know the triangle and tangent. With respect to that, I derived this equation, that is x by z equal to xp by d. So to get the value of xp, what I did, x divided by z by d. Okay, now same way, right from the side view, if I consider this side view, okay, I get the value of yp, y by z equal to yp by d. Okay, and yp, that's become yp equal to y divided by z by d. So if I consider this figure, I get the value of yp as this, and if I consider this figure, I get the value of xp as x by z by d. Next. Now I consider point P, a point on the space as x, y, z and 1. It is written in terms of matrix form because you know everything in computer graph. Any transformations which is happening, okay, or carried out, it is in terms of matrices itself. So they will be multiplied, ultimately the result will be in matrices. So those points or pixels. Okay, now consider M. There is a point P which is already considered, X, Y, Z and 1. And there is one more matrix M which I am going to consider is this one. That is 1 0 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 1 by D and 0. Okay, this is one matrix has been considered. Now what do I matrix M transform the point P to the point. Okay, so how it can be written? Q. Okay, the matrix M transforms the point P to the point Q. So how Q can be obtained? Q will become M into P. So Q is equal to what is the M matrix? This is above is the M matrix, and you know already P value is, P matrix value is X, Y, Z. So I multiply this, I will get the resultant matrix, which is the Q point. So the Q is X, Y, Z, Z by D. Okay. Now by dividing the first, okay, first three terms, that is Z by D, what I get is X divided by Z by D, Y divided by Z by D, and Z divided by D. So this is the Q dash, what I get. Okay, what I do, I divide these three terms divided by the last term. So X by X by D, Z by D, Y divided by Z by D, and Z by Z divided by D. Okay, and Z by D divided by Z by D is 1. Okay, now the result will be, now you know we already have this value already computed earlier, that is XP, YP and ZP. Okay, the above we have the values already calculated, that is XP is X by Z by D, YP is Z, Y by Z by D. So the same is going to be replaced here on these values. Okay, this is the value what I got, that is Q dash as per the above equations. Okay, so now therefore XP equal to X by Z, YP equal to Y by Z by D, and ZP. ZP how it is calculated? ZP equal to Z by Z by D. Okay, so this Z and this Z will be cancelled. So ZP will become the distance Z. Okay, this is how we evaluated ZP is equal to distance C, D. So this is already been shown in the figure. See here. This ZP is equal to distance D. Okay, so same way we need to calculate this D is equal to Z. Okay, that is going to be calculated. Okay, this is what I can say, the perspective matrix formed in terms of matrix, and ZP is evaluated to distance D. Okay, now in case of one more projection type is orthogonal or parallel projection, where the going to take the direction of D. Direction of DOP in the sense they are in the lines. So object will remain same as it was. This is the object. Okay. As and when the camera moves, there is no attenuation in the image. There is no reduction in the image size. Okay. The image will be same as that of previous. Okay. The parallel lines will be at infinite distance. Okay. They are not going to meet each other. So this is what orthogonal projection. Whereas in the person, lines will be COP. Here the COP will take the direction of projection, that is DOP. Okay, they won't meet each other. So such kind of projections are called the orthogonal projections, or they are also called as projections. Okay, now consider this figure. The orthogonal projections are such a projection in which cameras have infinite focal length. That is what I said. The projection lines, they won't meet each other. Okay, so this is the thing here. It has been shown in the figure here, the projectors are perpendicular to the view plane. The projectors are perpendicular to the view plane. The diagram says the projection plane with the Z value equal to 0, and the points are projected onto this plane. It can be noticed that they retain their X and Y values without change, and the diminution doesn't take place because there is no reduction in the size of X and Y, or the object remains same. Okay, throughout its view. So what I can have the value for xp and yp and zp, xp and yp, that is x and y values will not change. Okay, the point values will not change, so that will remain same as that of x and y. So xp is equal to x and yp equal to y and zp is equal to 0. So xp will be x, yp will be y and z is equal to 0 here. Okay, next. This above equations can be obtained in terms of matrix form now. So what I can take, I take a P point, P initial point in terms of matrix. So P is equal to x, 1. And I consider one more matrix, that is M, with these values, that is 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. Now what I do, okay, then we can obtain the orthogonal projection of the point P by multiplying M into P. Okay, so now we are going to get the Q value by multiplying matrix M with that of point P. So M matrix is represented here, that is 1 0 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 1 into this matrix, that is P value, that is point. Once I multiply M into P, that is this matrix into this, I get the values of these. Okay, so these value, that is x, y and 0. Once I multiply these value, this is the matrix value what I get. And this is same equal to as that of what we have already got the values for xp, yp and zp. Okay, so see here, xp, yp and zp is x, y and 0. The same values are x, y, 0, 1 is being replaced with xp, yp, zp and 1 because of this equation. Okay, this expression. Because here xp value is x, yp value is y and zp value is 0. So same is being replaced here. Okay, so instead of x, y, 0 and 1, I replace those x, y, 0, 1 with respect to xp, yp, zp values. Okay, because I've given here, because xp is equal to x, yp equal to y and zp equal to 0. Okay, next topic is, hope you have understood this. Okay, if you don't, then discuss. Okay, projection in OpenGL. Okay, so now we are going to learn about the projection in OpenGL. This is what you can see here in this figure. This is with respect to perspective projection, because you can see here, this is a view volume. Okay, this is actually the pyramid kind of structure, right? Okay, you have pyramid kind of structure, but it is halfway, it is cropped, somewhere cropped. So what I can say, this portion, what you have, the half portion of pyramid or half part, you can say this whole portion as a view volume. Okay, and this, the front face, what you can say is a view plane. Okay, or plane, and the back, what you can have is back clipping plane. Okay, this is completely the clipping plane, but inside portion or this boundary total is what you can see as a view volume, within which whatever picture comes, that will be displayed. Okay, and the picture which are goes out of this view volume will be clipped automatically, because there has to be some boundaries, right? For as view volume, I think so within that class I can say as it has a view volume, right? Okay, next, so it has a back clipping plane, you have a front clipping plane. Okay, next, at end As I said, this is a perspective projection. Every projection is going to meet at one point. You know that is called as COP, that is center of projection. COP. Okay, now we'll start with the explanation of this. A view column is also referred to as a frustum. Okay, so in the exam, probably they may ask you explain. Okay, once that question comes into your mind, this is the answer. Okay, you should draw this kind of figure. Okay, view volume is also referred to as a frustum. Objects falling within the view volume are displayed. Whatever the object comes under this view volume are only possible to be get displayed. Whereas the object falling outside this view volume is not possible to be get grabbed. The same way just now I given the class example. Okay, the view volume is the truncated pyramid with its apex at center of projection as shown in the figure. See, ultimately these all projection lines are meeting at one point called COP, center of projection. Okay, now open different functions for specifying perspective view volume, and there is only one function for specifying the parallel view plane. Okay, so what are the two functions which are used for perspective view volume? Okay, so one function is perspective viewing. The perspective view volume can be specified using GL matrix mode, GL underscore projection, because now you are supposed to so you need to set that specific mode, right? Okay, you need to set that specific mode. That's the reason I use GL matrix mode, GL underscore projection. Okay, next, GL load identity. As I said, maybe probably in the lab I or go for GL load identity. Load identity, why? Why? Because see, you are going to work on the matrix. Its values will not be changed. Okay, but it's the rule that you should have any translation. Is multiplication, so you should initially load the identity matrix. That's the reason the identity matrix is being loaded. Next, I'm going to use the function called as GL frustum. As you seen the figure earlier in the back slide, okay, to set that kind of perspective view, I must use the function called as GL frustum, and it has certain parameters, what I can say, a left, right, bottom, top, near and far. Okay, now this is going to create this kind of structure. Okay, this code of line is going to create this kind of structure. So you can see here, right, top, minus, near. This is what a view volume, right? And this is a COP. This is, they are going to meet at one point. Okay, this is a perspective projection. This is the right. This is where it is. This is at the right position. Whereas this point is at left position. Where exactly it is in this figure? This is at the top side. Whereas you have one more point here. This is at bottom. So I can say this as the right. This is at the top. But there is a front face and back face. Or this is the nearest and this is the farthest. Okay, so what I can say, this is the right point, this is the top point, and this is nearest. Okay, see here. So this is near, top, and at right side. Whereas this can be identified with, it is left now. Okay, as this point is at right, this point is at left. So left, same again, there is no change. It is at the top, and this is nearest. Okay, if I consider one more point, which is beside this. So beside this, though it is beside this, this is at far. So what I can say, right, this is the right top and far. Okay, now if I consider this point, what it is, what it could be, what it could be, it is, yes, this is at left side, this is at the top side, and this is far. And if I consider this point, this is at left side, this is at top side, and it is near. Only change is, here it is left. Getting? Okay. So, now if I consider this point, yeah, here it is already mentioned, this is at left, and this is at top bottom. Now, these all points are at top, but these four points, what you have see, is at the bottom side. So, left, it is at the left, it is at the bottom, and it is near. And if I want to consider this point, left, bottom, and far. And this point is what? This is the right, comma, bottom, comma, far. Okay? So, hence, every point is being considered through the GL frustum. Okay? This is how you can specify the frustum. There is one more way of representing the perspective view volume, that is through the glue perspective function. That is through one more function called as glue perspective, where you are supposed to use FOV, that is field of view. That is actually the angle. That is actually the angle with aspect. Aspect is, I will let you know, aspect comma near and far. So what exactly this aspect is? It is the ratio of width and height. Okay? It is the ratio of width and height. Whatever the window you have, okay, or view clipping volume, you must be having certain. That width and height is aspect ratio. That is the aspect ratio. That is view ratio of width and height. And this is focal, FOV, that is field of view. FOV is field of view and near and far. So how we can specify this? Yeah. Okay, this specification. Now what I specified here, GL matrix mode, again the projection mode on GL identity, load identity, I'm going to load the identity matrix, and I'm going to use, instead of GL frustum, I'm going to make use of glue perspective. This is something different function. Okay, as I said you, for perspective two functions are there. One is glue frustum, GL frustum, and one more is glue perspective. Okay, when I'm going to use the glue perspective, this is the format. Okay, this is the specification you should be doing, and you know this. And instead of this, I use here, which function? I'm going to use, okay, instead of GL plus term, I use the GL plus term. This is the specification for GL plus term. Instead of GL plus term, I'm going to make use of glue perspective. So now in the glue perspective, you have different parameters set, that is field of view, wide, aspect ratio, near and far. So this is how, once if I specify these lines, you are going to create such kind of specification for view volume. Okay, so this is field of view, this is the field of view, that is the angle, this is the width and height, that is aspect ratio, this is aspect ratio, and near and far. Okay, is it the near or the far one that you are supposed to mention? So this is what I can say, the glue perspective, and this is going to create the output like this. Okay, when it comes to the parallel or orthographic viewing in OpenGL, this is how it is. Orthographic viewing volume can be specified in OpenGL using this way, again same thing, okay, GL matrix mode, GL underscore projection. Okay, this is basically you should be following. Again load the identity matrix, that is GL load identity. Now instead of frustum or I'm going to use the GL ortho, because it is orthogonal, you know, This is, as it is the orthogonal projection, I am going to use the function called as GL ortho. Here the parameters are left, right, bottom, top, near and far. Okay, so there are GL2, 2D ortho, there are many functions with respect to again ortho. Okay, that is I think being used in your CG lab program. So here or there in your CG program, or if you forgot, you can open those programs and you can see there might be a chance that you may use this GL ortho function. Okay, maybe probably rotation of you just okay now the GL ortho has been specified using left, right, bottom, top, near, far as its parameters. Okay, next, this specification creates the following wave volume. Whatever I specify, this is going to create this kind of structure. Okay, so now as you know, okay, just now already I taught this point is going to be left, bottom, minus, near, and if I consider this left, bottom, and there's actually this is the far and this is the near. Okay, and yeah, this is the near, sorry, this is near, this is, as this is a front face, okay, front face, and this is a back panel or back face, this is the nearest point and this is the back point. Okay, so whatever comes inside this is this projection or this part is a view volume. Okay, whereas in the first term, the half part of pyramid, the is called as the view volume. Here whatever you can find within this structure is the view volume. Okay, now see here, this is the left, bottom, near. Okay, this is right, bottom and near. Okay, and if I consider this is right, top, so this is left, top, far, this is right, bottom, far. Okay, so every point can be considered. So here it is right, bottom, far, and so on. So every point have these values and you can identify it with these arguments. Next, okay, you have next topic. Okay, this is not going to be there for a portion, so I'll skip this. If you have any doubt, you can ask me if you want to learn. As this is not the part of a portion, I'm going to skip this. Directly what I can say is, I can go for one more topic. That is what I can say is, next topic I can say, hidden surface removal. I'll write certain notes with respect to this. Hidden surface removal is been identified with many names. Hidden surface removal Okay, there are two types here that I can specify. Here the hidden surface removal is also called as hidden surface removal algorithm. That is already I have written. Or I can say this as a visible surface algorithm also. Hidden surface removal or visible surface algorithm. In exam, they may ask you explain hidden surface removal or visible surface algorithm. This algorithm either removes those surfaces that should not be visible to the user. Be visible to the user. To the viewer, you can say. Or it will find which surfaces are visible, or find which surfaces are visible. You can say this as visible surface algorithm. So generally, what exactly it is? Hidden remove surface in the sense. Right now, see here, I am standing here. Or I can say I am holding certain book here. You know, okay, for your eyes, can capture anything, okay, they can detect, okay, this is one figure, one object, there is one more object. If I hold this, okay, you can view this, but whatever behind this book is not visible, okay, because your eye like camera is assumes, okay, this is at front, so this has to be visible. Backside of this, whatever the body portion of mine, backside of this book should not be visible. So you draw something behind to be visible object, no need to redraw them. So this is what I can say. Hidden surface removal, whatever the hidden surface, this is the hidden surface now, okay, because it is going to be hided by this book. So you remove this, need not to draw this item, okay. So that is what hidden surface removal, or whichever visible surfaces, only that need to be detected and shown onto the projection or shown onto the monitor, okay. So this is the hidden surface removal. There are again two kinds in this kind of algorithm. So one type is image space algorithm, and one more is going to make use of Z buffer. So first is image space algorithm. It works as part of projection process and seek to determine the relationship among object points on each projector, and second one you have is
object space algorithm. It attempts to order the surfaces of the objects in the scene such that rendering surfaces of the object in the scene, it attempts to order the surfaces of the object in the scene such that rendering surfaces in a particular order produces correct image. Produces a correct image. So the first method is, you can say image space algorithm. It is, you can say as one more name, Z buffer algorithm. This is called as Z buffer algorithm. First one is image space, and one more is object space algorithm. The image space works as part of projection process and seek to determine the relationship among the object points and on each projection. On each projection, it is going to find projection points, and based upon that, it is going to tell whether which you should not display. So it is in term going to use buffer called as Z buffer. So when I say it is density buffer with respect to any pixel, okay. So one more method what you have is object space algorithm. Object space algorithm attempt to order the surfaces of the object in the scene such that rendering the surfaces produces the correct image if they are ordered in a particular order, specific order. So these are the two methods. So in exam they may ask you, explain about the hidden surface removal or visible surface algorithm. If they ask, so you should specify two methods. One is image space algorithm and one more is object space algorithm. So they may even ask you, only explain the algorithm which is the Z buffer algorithm. When they ask you the Z buffer algorithm, you should only focus on image space algorithm technique, okay, because this image space algorithm is going to make use of Z buffer. Actually there will be two buffers implemented here. Next is I'm going to teach about the Z buffer method, then I will teach you the object space algorithm. The time is very short, within that I will cover the Z buffer. In the Z buffer, or I can say as depth buffer, this is under the image space method, okay? Remember, image space method, okay? Z buffer is under image space method. Okay, consider this figure. This is the Z, this is X, this is Y. There is a projection. These are the certain objects. I can say, and I can say this is S1, S2, S3 as objects. And there is a point through the projection XY. The projection is in this direction, that is projection is in this direction. And then I must consider from the view plane, which surface is closer, So here, this is a view plane. Now with respect to this, this one is closer, right? S1 is closer. So that must be calculated through this algorithm. So now, and you are supposed to calculate the intensity, and hence you get visible surface displayed. Okay, this is your job. Okay, now what I do is in term this algorithm will use two buffer usage. One buffer I can see it as buffer X comma Y for Z value calculation, and there is one more buffer, that is refresh X comma Y, that is for intensity of XY is being calculated. One is for Z value calculation and one is for intensity of that Z value pixel. Okay, so that is buffer XY and refresh XY. Okay, so now initially the Z color coordinates are normalized. Z coordinates are So Z coordinates are normalized here. That is what I can say, 0 is less than Z and it is less than 1. The value of Z lies between 0 and 1. Okay, so if 0 is value of Z, then it is a backspace, and if value of Z is 1, then it is the front face. Only remember this. Okay, so that value is in between 0 and 1. Okay, now algorithm starts here. So the first stage is initialize both the buffers, that is buffer X comma Y is equal to 0 and refresh X comma Y is Z background is value of Z, this. Okay, this is actually contains the intensity, right? Intensity of pixel X comma Y, that is current pixel for which we are going to calculate the Z value. Okay, next, so this buffer XY is actually what? These are the surface pixel, the current surface pixel on for which we are going to calculate the value of Z. Okay, next, initialize hone ke baad, second step is to calculate the z value for each position, okay, which is on the surface, okay, which is in the surface, and then check what you are supposed to check. If if z is greater than the depth of xy. Depth of xy. If it is, what you are supposed to do? Depth of, if it is so, then depth of xy is equal to z. And refresh, what you are supposed to do? Refresh of xy, the current value of z. Okay, that is refresh z surface value has to be initialized here. Refresh ko intensity has to be initialized. So what is that intensity? The value of z surface values of that pixel xy. Okay? Okay, this is the second stage. Third, where should I write? I mentioned here itself. Third step is, after processing all surface, we will get visible surface in depth x comma y, and its intensity values in refresh x comma y. Okay, after calculating this second, first we initially initialize the buffer value and refresh buffer. Both the buffers are initialized. This is the first stage. Secondly, what you are supposed to calculate? Calculate the z value for each position. Each position we must consider. Whatever the first surfaces, you have n number of pixels. For those n number of pixels, you are supposed to calculate the z values. Okay, that is the depth value you are supposed to calculate. If z is greater than the depth of xy, if the current value of depth is something, okay, if it is greater than the currently found value, if that, then initialize depth of xy is equal to z. Because that is the current one, is the bigger one. And then initialize that the pixel values to the refresh rate. That is, intensity has to be set with the current value of that pixel. Okay, then this has to be done for, after all processing all the surface values for all the pixels, we will get the visible surface in what depth of xy, whichever the bigger value that is going to be get into the depth of xy, and respective intensity value is going to be taken into refresh comma x comma y, and hence we get the larger values, and hence we can say this surface is visible. This is visible. So this surface is visible. Not this one. Then this, it has no value as I already defined. Okay, greater than 0 and less than 0. Okay, as I already said you. Value 0 is back facing. Okay? And if the value is 1, then it is a front facing. Okay? So probably in here, whichever having a higher value will be having a